Good evening, everyone. And today at Vidhi Adda, we are going to discuss about a woman who broke all kind of misconception which is there due to, we can say that, gender stereotypes. As we all know that gender equality has always been a major issue in India, but many women, we often find that they have managed to break the barriers and they enter into fields that were earlier dominated by men. And these women, they have shown a very great courage in entering the unusual professions, and not just entering, they have also excelled in their respective fields. So the women that we'll talk about, her life symbolizes the grit of women to overcome the struggles and prove their worth. She broke the glass ceiling in those days, and even today the women, they are very much motivated by her work as well as her attitude, which encourage the women that are there who want to make their career in science. So she is none other than Kamala Sohoni. So people often think that science and women, this is a very unusual combination. But Kamala Sohoni broke this misconception. If we talk about her personality, she is a woman of very few words. So one might be very deceived by her looks. He might think that a woman who is quite like her must have chosen a field which is also very quiet or easy or uneventful. But it was not so. She had many hurdles to cross, many rapids to pass before she could become a woman known as Women in Science. That too when she had full support from her family. She was the first. She was not the first woman to get a PhD in science. The first woman was E.K. Janaki Amma, but Kamala Sohoni, she was the first one to get her PhD degree in science from a British university. That was Cambridge University. So if I talk about her childhood, she was brought up by a very highly educated family. Her father, her uncle, they were the first chemists to graduate from the Indian Institute of Science, which is now, which is previously known as the Tata Institute of Sciences. So she was very much influenced by her background, by her father and uncle. So as a university topper, she thought that it would be very easy to get admission for further studies at Indian Institute of Sciences, Bangalore. But shockingly for her, the reality didn't align well with her expectations. She was refused to get an admission of her desired college, and she was rejected by none other than C.V. Raman. He refused to grant her admission on account of her being a girl. So she, she also mentions this thing in her book, that she said that though Raman was a great scientist, he was very narrow-minded. And she said that I can never forget the way he treated me just because I was a woman. After she got her admission, her work was enough to prove that she is so much devoted in her work that a year later, Raman allowed her to be a student and pursue research in biochemistry further. She also, in later stage of her life, she got a research scholarship at the prestigious Cambridge University in order to pursue her PhD. And then she became the first Indian woman to get a PhD in science discipline, that too from the Cambridge University. In addition to these achievements, she stepped beyond the confinement of academics, and she also worked for the betterment of quality of lives in her country that fulfills her duty towards the society as a scientist. She was presented with the Rashtrapati Award for her work on the drink. There was a drink called Neera, which was held to be a very important food, especially for the malnourished children. And this became an inexpensive dietary supplement that could be added to the diets of malnourished adolescents as well as the pregnant women who were there from the tribal community. So in order to talk further into her achievements, that how she broke the ceiling of gender stereotype, Vedant will discuss further.
Thank you very much, Anupama. You gave a very great and in detailed description about her entire biography, her life. And firstly, people may not know who is Dr. Kamala Soni, the viewers may just wonder who is she. So as rightly pointed out by you, she is the first Indian girl, women who obtained PhD from a foreign university in a scientific discipline. So this is our greatest achievement. And of course, there are various achievements which you highlighted. The point is, in the year 1848, we all know the revolution by Savitribai Phule and Mahatma Phule, which took place, and the first girls' school was started in Pune, right? And the efforts of Maharshi Dhondo Keshav Karve, he was responsible for enacting the university for the girls. It was in 1929. We know the efforts taken by Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj for women education. We know the efforts of reformation taken by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar also during this period. Then the 20th century was itself known for reformations in India. But still, a thing happened which put a doubt on this reformation. In the year 1930, great scientist and great child of India, Dr. C.V. Raman, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for his contribution for the Raman effect. And we all should be proud of this, definitely. In 1933, Dr. Kamala Soni, she passed out from Bombay University in BSc. And when she applied for her further studies in IISc Bangalore, and she was the university topper, mind you, and not she was not having any reservation. She was a university topper on merit. And she was deserving candidate. When her application was rejected outrightly by IISc Bangalore administration, and when her father and herself went to the administration, and there was a conversation between Nobel laureate Dr. C.V. Raman and that time Kamala Bhagwat, her name before marriage was Kamala Bhagwat, and her father. That time the conversation is very shocking. Dr. C.V. Raman outrightly rejected her application on the grounds that she was a woman, openly. And the reasons he gave, that firstly, you will pollute the environment of the college. Because when girls and boys will come together, there will be love. I am openly telling this. And this was the open conversation. Then, the girls are always married earlier. So she will not be able to complete her entire education. She will pollute the environment. She will leave the college. And the resources of the college will be wasted. This was the other reason stated by Dr. C.V. Raman. Thirdly, girls cannot do physics and science. This was the fourth point. And after hearing all these things, Dr. Kamala Soni was a great Gandhian follower. She was inspired by Mahatma Gandhi's non-violence principles, Satyagraha, Ahimsa, and truth. She very quietly said that I will not go from here, and she sat in between the door of the entrance of the cabin, and she did an andolan that unless you admit me in IISc Bangalore, I will not go from here. Of course, Gandhian principles had to win, and the great Gandhian principles were successful. And C.V. Raman was forced to give the admission to Kamala Soni. But this admission was not so easy. She had, there were criteria, as you said, there was a 1 year probation period in which she had to prove that I can be a good student. And yes, she did. She was successful. And the stories go like that she used to wake up at 5 o'clock in the early morning and go to the professor and study. Because during the daytime, she couldn't study with the boys. Just imagine 1933's. And we had great social reformers from Agarkar and Savitribai Phule, Mahatma Phule, who in 1848-49 stated that there should be women education and girls and women should study together. And just imagine this Nobel laureate, a great person, indeed a great person, had such a stereotype. So somewhere this was in the roots of our patriarchy, which we Indians have. And ultimately, she was successful in her higher studies. She passed out from IISc Bangalore. She went to Cambridge. And this description is very interesting. An Indian girl wearing the Nawari sari. Nowadays, Nawari sari is said to be very traditional occasion. I hope our viewers know what is Nawari sari. So, a girl wearing Nawari sari in Cambridge University and doing the experiments of physics, chemistry there were shocking to everyone. And people were wondering and seeing her what exactly she was doing and what exactly she was wearing. And I think, Anupama, you mentioned all the achievements, the discovery of cytochrome C or the discovery of all the other nutrients are all the credit of Kamala Sohoni. Her PhD thesis is also very historical. In just, I think, 14 months, she was able to write her PhD thesis of 40 pages. But that PhD thesis is not is of so much of use. The discovery of cytochrome C is very essential. And whenever there is a mention of cytochrome C, there is a discovery, we can say, the name of Dr. Kamala Sohoni. So just in 14 months, 40 pages thesis. And there is one more point to highlight. She was given the opportunity of teaching in Cambridge and having opportunity of other higher studies also in Cambridge. She rejected this opportunity and she said that I want to work with Mahatma Gandhi's movement. It was 1942's, the Quit India movement. So this was the great down-to-earth person. The point of discussion here is that how, despite of all the social reformers, all the social reform movements by great Savitribai Phule, Mahatma Phule, Agarkar, or by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, or by anyone, couldn't reform the great Nobel laureate Professor Dr. C.V. Raman that time. Of course, indeed, in the latter stage when Dr. Kamala Sohoni was successful, he apologized publicly for rejecting her. But it is famously said, there is a quote that boon se gai hot se kya aegi. That time she was humiliated. She was rejected just on the basis of her gender. Today, that time she was successful. That's why C.V. Raman apologized. Just for the sake. Of course, I don't know whether he reformed or not. And of course, then he was awarded the Bharat Ratna. And he became Bharat Ratna Nobel laureate Professor Dr. C.V. Raman. And the opinion of Kamala Sohoni didn't change even after apology. As you rightly mentioned in her book, she stated that though he was very educated, but he held this stereotype. And this stereotype should be changed. And if we see, how are we going to connect this to the current situation? There are instances till today also that women in science are looked down upon. Women in physics, chemistry are looked down upon. So somewhere we should introspect ourselves And I would recommend all the viewers to kindly read my article. And I have also attached various links for citations for in my article. They can refer that also. And also they can read her biography in detail to understand the stereotypes and the hardships that Dr. Kamla had to face. I have just briefly mentioned. Now just imagine in Bangalore when she was rejected, and that time when the society was patriarchal. There, though there were reforms, but the society inherently was patriarchal. And fortunately, her parents supported her. This was the greatest thing, as Anupama rightly mentioned. She belonged to a very great family where her father, her uncle were the alumni of Tata Institute of Social Sciences, the same college that is now IIC Bangalore. And secondly, her sister Durga Narayan Bhagwat. Durga Narayan Bhagwat is a very great Marathi writer, literature. Everyone might know her, or you can just search her name on Google. She was a very great writer in Marathi language, especially awarded with various awards in literature. So with this great background, she got a very good support. And as she was well-to-do economically, she could afford everything. But the point is, what if she was not, what if she was from a poor family? She would have become nothing, and just because of the stereotype. So this is the point. What do you say, Anupama, after my description?
Yeah, you very rightly mentioned that she had all the resources, whether it comes to education or her family was also very well to do. And you know, for girls, it is very important that she is getting all the required support from her family. If she is having the support of her family, one of the hurdle is already crossed. So this was very the support of her family. I think this was one of the very important factor which led to her successful career in science. And as you say that like if you talk about science, so again, science may be there is inequity, a field which is, you know, we can say that a field which precludes the bias and discrimination by its very design. So this somehow presents that what will be the stage of inequality in the spaces where gender really matters. Like science, in my opinion, science is having a very neutral nature. But now we can see the recent developments when we talk about the inclusion of women in higher posts of army, and also somehow these were the fields where women were considered to be not required. But science is a field which is very neutral in nature, and it can be excelled by anyone who is smart enough, intelligent enough to grasp the concepts. So
That's all. As you mentioned, Anupama, here, the army part. Still today, 2021, women are fighting for their rights in army also. So just imagine the level of patriarchy imbibed in our roots, in our veins, in our heart. And very running example I would like to give. I was attending a webinar on 26th of November, which was given delivered by Nishtha Satyam, Ms. Nishtha Satyam. And she is the UN women head of Timur and Liste. And she said that whenever we say constitution makers, we say founding fathers. And it is important to note that the Constituent Assembly had as many as 15 women. Educated women, and they contributed also. Then how come we say that founding fathers? So what about our founding mothers? And this is not only for this Constitution Day. You just minutely go back on 15th August and see all the great leaders' speeches. The dream of our founding fathers. This is their statement. why it is the dream of the founding father and why not founding mother. So that's why I came with a very innovative term. Why not stop saying all these founding father and founding mother? Let's say founding parents. And you just realize you are also a law student and you have read the constitutional law. Have you ever said in your entire law school founding mothers of our constitution? Never. We always write the dream of our founding fathers were liberty, equality, fraternity. This is our statement randomly. So this is how our patriarchal society is. So if you have anything to say here on this point.
You know, as you mentioned about the freedom struggle, you know, I think the freedom that we cherish today would not have been possible if the incredible women who helped India in getting in the freedom struggle, whether I talk about their contribution in terms of being there with Mahatma Gandhi, Savitri Bai Phule, or if we talk about Mahadevi Verma, or we talk about Captain Lakshmi Sehgal, Rani Lakshmibai. These all are example that they were very essential part of our freedom struggle. And if someone if we are not recognizing their their devotion in our struggle, then I think that it somehow disrespects their
or the efforts that they took for our national our freedom.
Right. Are you speaking something? Your voice was breaking.
No.
Yes.
No. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you're audible. Okay. And you were audible.
Okay. Theek hai.
Yes. So with this, I think we can come to an end because this article was very short. But this article was very. And if viewers might have strike their mind, just always remember, don't say founding fathers, say founding parents. A very interesting point, which it striked my mind since on that webinar I attended, that why don't we say founding mothers? And there were so many, 15, as many as 15 women members. So where did they go? Or are they included in the founding fathers term? This is a big question. And go and try to connect this article, try to connect this stereotypes with the current situation also. As Anupama rightly mentioned, the issue of a permanent commission or the issue of our women in army or various things. Whenever we say women is going in science, physics or scientists, we always look down upon. Whenever we say a woman wants to become a practicing advocate, we look down upon. We say it's not your job. I think, Anupama, you might have experienced this somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. Even high courts, they are very, very much a male dominating thing. You will never see a female, you will rarely see a female who is very senior or who has, achieved that seniority there, because this is very practical. Law field mate really takes too much experience to get on that field. And you also need contacts as well as support from the entire fraternity which is there. So somehow women they don't get support, and the one reason I can say that the ratio which is there also there is a very large gap between the male members and the female members which are there in the courts. So but the second thing is that male dominated profession never they never change. They will never think that, yeah, like she's doing a great job, let's support her. Like somehow it hurts their what to say, that male ego. I'm not getting the right word here, but somehow they think that it will hurt their ego if they if there is any senior person who is a woman. So yeah,
right. So I think we can conclude our session.
Okay, so we'll thank you to all the viewers, and you can check out the link of the article that was written by Vedant on Kamala Soni. And